Welcome back to part two, creating a database. To start, you'll need access to a database server. For those of you watching as a CSE student, you can get access through our website systems FAQ. For those of you that are not CSE students, you will need to set up your own database server. You also need a client to connect to and interact with the server. If you like working from the command line, you can use the command line interface. I'll quickly demonstrate how to connect using the command line interface. I've already logged into CSE using my login and password. You can start the MySQL client by typing the following: MySQL U, your username, P, where CBERC is replaced with your login. The program will then prompt for a password. The client has now started and you can start to type commands. For example, to use your database, type use CBERC, where CBERC is again replaced with your login. Then you can show the tables that currently exist and describe them using the following commands. Show tables. Describe game. Unless you've already created tables, your database should be empty. An alternative is to use a graphical user interface client. Many such programs exist, but I'll demonstrate using MySQL Workbench as it is free and available for download at the given URL. Once you've started MySQL Workbench, you can connect to your database by creating a new connection. Name your connection and use the host cse.unl.edu, port 3306, and your CSE login and MySQL password. Once connected, you can now start typing queries and commands in the editor. To execute the current query, you can type Control Enter. To execute all the queries in the editor, you can type Control Shift Enter. The results are displayed at the bottom frame. Note that you will only have access to a single database and cannot create others. On your own database server, you would have permissions to create as many databases as you want. Nevertheless, you can store multiple tables from different databases under your database on CSE with no problem. To manage your password and other system questions, you can use the links provided. For security reasons, your database password should not be the same as your login password. Now that we're connected, let's start by creating some tables. The syntax for creating a table is as follows. Create table, then you provide the table name. Table names are case sensitive and will use a modern upper camel casing convention. It is best to avoid pluralization so that if you create a table of student records, it would be best to name it student. Within parentheses, you provide a comma delimited list of columns. Each column is specified with the name and type followed by any options. We'll use a lower camel casing convention in our column names. Options may include designating a column as a primary key and allowing it to be auto-incremented. You can also specify that the column is not allowed to contain null values. By default, column values are allowed to be null. You can also specify default values for columns. If a record is inserted without a value for a column, the default is provided. There are many column types that are supported by various database systems. We'll only focus on a few of the most useful ones. Varchar stands for Variable Character or String Field. Typically, you provide a value that specifies the maximum number of characters in the field. If a string is too long to fit in the maximum allowable characters, it is typically truncated. The characters that do not fit are ignored and a warning is raised. Numbers are supported either as integers or as decimal values using the keywords integer or int, decimal, float, or double. Most databases support even more column types or aliases. Aliases are shorthand names used for common column types. For example, text is used in some systems to denote a 64 kilobyte varchar column. Some databases support date-time types or even full JSON JavaScript object notation formats. Here's a full example of a full table containing book records. Note that each column definition ends with a comma except for the last one. The command, like all SQL commands, ends with a semicolon. We've designated the first column to be an integer, which is also a primary key auto-incremented by the database, and it's not allowed to be null. The title column is able to hold titles up to 255 characters long, and also not allowed to be null. The author column is similar, but by default is allowed to be null. The ISBN column is allowed to be null and has a default value of an empty string. The key difference here is that someone would be allowed to insert a new book record without an ISBN, in which case it becomes the empty string value. However, you would not be allowed to change the value to null for any record later on. In contrast, the numCopies column is allowed to be null, but has a default value of 0. If you insert a record without a value for the column, it takes on the value 0. However, you could update any record to take on null values for this column. Recall that a primary key gives each and every record a unique identity. It is best practice that every table you define have a primary key. You can define tables to have what is called a composite key that may consist of more than one column. In general, you should not allow null values for primary keys. You could, but since it must be unique, only one record would be allowed to have a null value, which is of little use. You should also let the database auto-generate your primary key. Key management is a difficult problem and is easily solved by the RDBMS, so let it do its job. External identifiers such as social security numbers, ISBNs, etc. should not be used. Moreover, you should use integers and not varchars or decimal numbers as primary keys. We'll discuss the reasons for these best practices in subsequent videos. You can also define keys in a table that are not primary. Such a key can ensure that the values in the columns are unique. You can also define composite keys in which a combination of columns must be unique. A key can also be defined that is not necessarily unique. Multiple records may then have the same value. The purpose of such a key is so that the database can index the records for quick, efficient retrieval of data. In general, any column that you wish to be searchable should have a key index placed on it. In SQL, you can use the keyword index instead of key, as they are synonyms. You can also use the keyword unique to enforce unique values. In the full syntax, you would use the keyword constraint and provide a name for that constraint. To place an index on multiple columns, you can use the same syntax as before, providing a comma delimited list of columns. Recall that relations between data in different tables can be modeled using foreign keys. Typically, a foreign key is a column that references a primary key in another table. When foreign keys are defined, data cannot be inserted into tables without a proper reference. That is, if we want to insert a record that references another record, that reference record must exist first. Several types of relations can be defined. A one-to-one relation is where one record in table A refers to exactly one record in table B and vice versa. One-to-one relations should generally be avoided as it indicates that the data likely belongs in the same table. One-to-many and many-to-one relations are the same thing but from different perspectives. One record in table A may refer to multiple records in table B. Multiple here may mean one or more or even zero records. In the same scenario, from the perspective of table B, there is a many-to-one relationship with table A. There are also many-to-many relationships that can be modeled using a third join table. As previously mentioned, referenced records must exist before the records that reference them do. Moreover, when deleting records, it is required that we delete referenced records first. Otherwise, the referencing records would refer to deleted data which violates the foreign key constraint. To define foreign keys, you use the following syntax. Let's combine all of these elements into a small demonstration. We'll write SQL to define two tables, one for authors and one for books. Separating the two tables means that we're no longer repeating the same author for multiple book records. We'll also ensure that ISBN values are unique by placing a unique index constraint on it. Finally, we'll create a relationship between these two tables to model the fact that one author may have written multiple books. Some books may have multiple authors, in which case we would want to model a many-to-many relationship, but we'll keep it simple for now. Let's start by documenting our script. Recall that comments can be made using the hash mark. Now let's create a table for book records. We'll use the same syntax as before. We'll include an integer primary key that is not null and is automatically generated and assigned by the database. We'll also define a title, ISBN, and numCopies fields as before. Values in the title column are allowed to be null, but the ISBN is not. Now let's place a uniqueness constraint and index on the ISBN field to ensure that no two book records can share the same ISBN number. To do that, the syntax is constraint followed by the constraint name. I'll name it unique ISBN. Then unique index followed by the column on which you want to place the index. How do we take care of the author? We'll need a separate table in order to model that one author may have written several books. We'll create a simple author table with a primary key, first and last name columns. Note that we followed the convention of naming primary keys after the table, followed by an ID. We now need to relate these two tables together. We could place a foreign key in the author table referring to a particular book record. However, for each author record, that would mean that it could only refer to one book. That is, this would define a many-to-one relationship from the author table to the book table. What we want is to place a foreign key in the book table that refers to the author that wrote it. That way, several book records can refer to the same author, defining a one-to-many relationship from the author table to the book table. We first need to add the column to the book table. I've made sure that the foreign key has the same name as the primary key that it refers to. This is not a requirement, just good practice. I've also made sure that the types match. They're both integers and both not allowed to be null. We now need to define the foreign key to reference a particular column in another table. Let's try to run this script to see if it works. There was an error. The problem is that we tried to create the book table, which references the author table, before the author table actually existed. Changing the order in which we create the table should fix this problem. Now it works. When writing scripts to create a database from scratch, you can also conditionally drop the tables if they already exist so that the script can recreate them. Take care when doing this, as dropping a table erases all the data that was contained in them. Once again, there's an error. Recall that we created the author table first because book referenced it. When dropping the tables, we must do so in reverse order. The author table cannot be dropped first because the book table refers to it. Book must be dropped first to get rid of the reference. Then, once nothing references author, it can be dropped. Now everything works. We can save our script as a plain text file. We can also use MySQL Workbench to generate an entity relation or ER diagram for us. This provides a graphical representation of our tables. Go to File, New Model. In the new model, go to File, Import, Reverse Engineer SQL Script. Select the file we just created, and be sure that Place Imported Objects on a Diagram is selected. Upon execution, we have our diagram. The one-to-many relationship is modeled with a chicken foot connection. One to many. In the next part, we'll cover how to insert and manipulate data in these tables.